If faith is twofold, then tell me your faith. You know what I'm about teaching? See, we are laborers together with God. But God used my wife to say this. You know, when I hear things, I go into research mode. I go into prayer and research mode. When I get a revelation of something, I need to find out more about it. So I understand that in faith, because faith comes by hearing, right? So once God said it, now faith is kicked in. So now I have my part to play. He has his part to play. So in faith, I'm a co-laborer together. So the integrity is true faith. In the integrity of faith depends on first the integrity of God's word and then the integrity of my belief. Preach, y'all, get up. See, if you don't get it right away, I'm going to be patient with you because it's time to grow. Someone say amen. The integrity of faith has to do with two things. The integrity of God's promise and the integrity of my belief. The completeness and the truth of his promise and the completeness of truth of what I believe. So when I talk about the integrity of the system of faith, it means that God said something to a start, but first I have to understand the integrity of his promise. Can I stop here? Because without this, faith does not work. I have to understand what God has shown me from the beginning of time, how serious he is about his promise. Because the truth of the matter is, many of us in church don't believe God's promises. And that's why we are stuck as a people. Can I stop you? Please hear my heart. That's why we are stuck as a people. It's easy to push us away. It's really easy to push away because you can push away and still be in church. But the problem with us is, why faith is not working is because faith starts with the integrity of a promise from God. So faith starts with this. God said it. I don't care what nobody else say. I know it's true. We've lost that. Can we talk here? We've lost our trust in God. We compromise it too much. The minute trouble comes, we go to another plan. Yes, sir. But when God's authenticating your faith, instead of waiting to see how you're going to act after you fail. How you going to act after I take it from you? Peter and Job. If you believe what I say, can I go back to Adam? And I taught this on Wednesday night to those who come. See, from the original plan of God, you're going to give me a minute to do this because I don't want you to get excited. I want you to get this here so you can be at peace at home and won't quit on this journey when you're so close to your change. In the original fellowship with God, God set up a program that says, when I make you a promise, believe it. No matter what else I tell you, believe what I promise you. The first promise God made to man was, if you touch that tree, you will die. He gave him everything else, Q. He said, you need everything else. I give you all this gold. I give you all this stuff coming here. Do anything you want to, but I promise you this. If you touch that tree, you will die. And then you say, oh God, help me. When we deal with promises, I want to take you back to this place so you can understand how serious God is about a promise. We take it too lightly in church. I'm trying to get us all to repent, Cornetta. I'm trying to show you how serious God is. You got to take it serious when you get a promise. Yes. It's not just a word from the preacher. It's a declaration and a pledge from God. So if you can't stand it, God said this, I don't care if I go to the cross and stand in it, then you didn't believe it. Adam didn't believe that God said to him, if you touch that tree, you're going to die. God sent it up because he would never touch it. He would have never touched it. Why am I giving you this story? Because I'm showing you the integrity of promise. Because our relationship with God from the beginning is based on promise. God don't need something from you. You can't give him nothing. It's based on promise. And until you and I repent and begin to get our focus on, God promised me something. I know that's going to come to pass. It doesn't matter what I go through in the time being. I'm holding on to what God said. And many of us died in the process, because we didn't believe the promise. So when I talk about the integrity of faith, the first thing I got to get down on table is the integrity of a promise. May I stop and ask you, what does God promise you? How many of us know the promise that he made when he blessed us? Because if God said it, I have to believe whether you believe or not. I got to believe for myself. No matter what the devil said, no matter what my wife said to Job, I still got to believe. I got to hold on to the integrity of that promise because my integrity is based on his integrity.
Yes! Yes!
Am I preaching good here?
Yes.
My integrity to believe is based on his integrity to fulfill.
Yes.
Wow. So if I know that he said it, he had to fulfill it. So now it makes it a little bit easier for me to believe it than it ever breaks loose.
Yes.
Because when he's authenticating your belief, it's going to look like he lied. Good God for Christ. Is anybody here with me?
Yes.
I came to talk about the integrity of faith. But what it boils down to is that we, as church, we don't do it no more. It boils down to believing God. And to understanding that when you go through something, Job, when you go through something, Peter, he's only trying to authenticate your faith. When the enemy accuses you of being a church folk and a person, not a believer, God says, I'm going to show you. So I'm going to break them down and show you they're not going to quit.
God,
I'm preaching good here. Let me slow down and get a bit. Let me get this anointing. Because I didn't come here for no. I came here to release the fire of the word. I didn't come here for no big hallelujah. When I see that stuff on Facebook, man, I cut it off. Did that devil and put that on the black people right now. All we go to do is go to church and dance in the Holy Ghost. You look on Facebook, everybody dancing the Holy Ghost, having a good time. But we defeated. Good God. I'm a heavenly over here. I have to understand that the integrity of my faith is based on the integrity of God's promise. So that faith cometh by hearing. So I have to know this. I'm going to teach you how to feel this. I have to know that God, who is my Father, is also the judge of the earth. Remember Abraham told him when he was going to kill everybody in Sodom and Gomorrah? Abraham said, you being the judge of the earth, you know I'm going to do the right thing? You can kill the righteous with the wicked? What if I can find 50 righteous people? God said, I'll save you for 50. The only problem is Noah's nephew, Lot family, we had 8 people in it. And he come off a 10. And so he said, God said, if you can find 10, I'll save the city. But it was only Lot and his family. Everybody else was unrighteous. They didn't know who God was. They didn't know who the Son was. It wasn't so much about what they were doing. They were just so set. Come on. They didn't know who God was. They were just doing what they were doing, what they wanted to do, and they didn't know who God was. So God said, you can find 10 people who believe me.
10.
I'll save the city. And Abraham said then, I'm taking you somewhere. You being the judge of all the earth, are you not going to do right and do the God of righteousness? You mean to tell me I'm taking you somewhere. I think it's James who said, James called him the righteous judge of all creation. This message is going a little a different way now. Y'all pray for me here. So you listen, your Father now, I'm going back to promises. You try to tell me that God, who is the righteous judge, I feel the Holy Ghost. Prepare yourself for what's coming. I don't know how it's coming, but prepare. You try to tell me that the sovereign God. See, the problem is that, can I ask a question before I move on? Do you believe God?
Yes, I do.
Do you believe that no matter what you see or feel, you believe what God says?
Yes.
It cannot be possible that the sovereign God of creation, the judge of the whole world, who gave you the right to come boldly under the throne of grace, and come boldly before the court, have made your pledge and will not keep it. It is not possible. It is absolutely impossible that God will not keep his pledge to you. I'm talking about faith, but I don't feel like I got no believers here. Let me say it again. Do you believe? I believe Genesis chapter 18 calls it the judge, the righteous judge of the world. He judges the whole earth. And he's your Father, he chose you. Talking about faith. Because I'm talking about what? The integrity of a promise. So when God makes a promise, that promise has come from the one who created all things, who's going to judge all things, who's already judged you innocent. So you God's reputation is on the line where his promise is concerned. That's why, in all of his love, can I teach this? I don't have time.
Take your time.
See, God is not going to allow his love to subvert his promise. It does not matter how much he loves you, he's not going to change what he promised. He told Adam, if you touch that tree, player, you won't die. He loved Adam as much as he loved Jesus. He loved Adam as much as he loved you and I. But he couldn't change his promise because his promise is his integrity. Are you all walking with me here? So God's love for me is not going to change in the promise he made to me. His love for you is not going to change. That's why the book says he's magnified his word above all his name. He took away his own power to change his promise. Somebody needs to say
hallelujah.
Are you getting this? This is where we're coming to the people. But it's going to take a personal commitment to this thing. This is not going to happen in your church. This is going to happen in your private time with God. This is going to happen when you understand that you have the right to go before the throne of God and forget about everybody else. and understand what your legal rights are in the kingdom. Because your Father is the righteous judge.